So what happens when you take your loved one to the doctor? Do they simply talk to you and your loved one and make a diagnosis? What if they make the wrong conclusion? Is there any sure shot thing like a physical evidence of having schizophrenia, like a change in the body parts, say in the brain? As a family member or friend of someone with psychosis, I'm sure we've all gone through these kind of questions at some point. Let's unfold these doubts in detail over this video. Yes, there are some structural changes in the brain that have been found in people with schizophrenia. But no, so far they're not used for diagnostic purposes. For most of the research I've done personally, it's not clear whether it's a cause or result of developing schizophrenia. But there is evidence of these changes in the brain, meaning we are not just talking about the psychological impact, but a physical change that can be seen via MRI scans. To understand what this change is, just know that our brains have interconnected cavities called ventricles. Here, you can see them in a 3D modeling. The highlighted blue parts are the ventricles. They are essentially cavities, you know, just blank spaces. They aren't made up of any material. But of course, they have their important role. Cerebrospinal fluid circulates in the brain through these ventricles, and perhaps if not for these ventricles, the brain would collapse. Now, according to research, these ventricles seem to enlarge in a person with schizophrenia over time, compared to the brain of someone who doesn't have it. As we can see, there are physical changes in the brain that can be verified via MRI scans. However, this is not a diagnostic criteria, because this enlargement of ventricles is often developed over a period of time and might not be present when the person starts developing symptoms. Or in some cases, they might be present even before birth, you know, when the person was still in their mother's womb. And there are still studies going on to see if there is a correlation between onset of symptoms and these enlarged ventricles. Probably even more global studies to find out if this could help in potential clinical treatments or even pave the way for predicting who can develop schizophrenia or find predictors for specific symptoms, etc. But as far as diagnosis is concerned, as of now, that is mostly done by reading symptoms according to the medical diagnostic manuals as applicable in your country. Let's take a look at those. The diagnosis is usually done by a licensed psychiatrist who would generally sit down and talk with the person to understand their condition. I hope you remember the positive, negative, and disorganized symptoms we discussed earlier. The psychiatrist would observe the person's behavior and talk to them to identify if any of these symptoms are present and whether these symptoms have persisted for over a certain duration. And based on that, they make a diagnosis. While following DSM V, it could be an acute diagnosis, which would be called schizophrenia form, or a chronic diagnosis, which is what we know as schizophrenia. Now, you might wonder what DSM V is and why I left things a bit ambiguous, like, oh, it's based on having symptoms over a certain duration, right? The thing is, depending upon your country, there could be different diagnostic manuals that doctors around you follow. And accordingly, the rules to diagnose schizophrenia could differ at least slightly. Although these changes are more or less insignificant, because most countries follow one of the two guides, the DSM V or ICD 11. And both of them have very similar criteria when it comes to diagnosing schizophrenia. DSM stands for Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders. It's a publication by the American Psychiatric Association. And of course, the purpose is to provide classification of mental disorders using a common language and standard criteria. DSM V is just their latest edition that was published in March 2022. If a diagnosis is to be made while following DSM V, key criteria symptoms such as either delusion or hallucination or disorganized speech have to be present for at least 1 month, and there has to be a social or occupational impact in the life of the person for at least 6 months. The reason for this social or occupational impact is to give emphasis on the fact that these symptoms are so strong that they directly impact your ability to live meaningfully. So scenario one is, someone has symptoms for at least 1 month or more and 6 months or more of impact on social or occupational life, then the diagnosis of schizophrenia is made. Of course, ruling out all other possibilities. Scenario two is, symptoms have been there for 1 month or more, but social or occupational impact has not been there for at least 6 months so far. Then a diagnosis of schizophrenia form is made. And finally, if the symptoms are there but haven't been there for at least 1 month so far, then it's considered a brief psychotic disorder. Of course, all acute diagnoses like schizophrenia form and brief psychotic disorder can over time change to chronic and become full-fledged schizophrenia if the conditions persist with time. ICD, on the other hand, is the International Classification of Diseases. It's a globally used medical classification maintained by WHO, which is part of the UN. ICD-11 is the latest addition that came into effect from 1st January 2022. Its diagnostic criteria for schizophrenia are more or less similar to that of DSM, at least DSM-5, with minor differences, such as there is no schizophrenia form diagnosis. So it usually doesn't rely on having at least 6 months of social or occupational impact. In fact, it doesn't focus much on the social occupational impact part. As long as the symptoms have persisted for at least 1 month, the diagnosis can be made. So scenario one, symptoms have persisted for at least 1 month or more, schizophrenia is diagnosed. Scenario two, symptoms are there but haven't been there for at least 1 month, then the doctors are not sure what form it could take over time. So to be on a precautionary side, it's diagnosed as unspecified primary psychotic disorder. Nevertheless, as you see, it's very important for a psychiatrist to understand the symptoms in order to arrive at the correct diagnosis. Which brings us to the next question. What are some of the things to keep in mind when visiting a doctor with your loved one so that the doctor can get the right picture and make the right diagnosis? Let's learn about that and the general prognosis of schizophrenia in the next episode. Until then,